Hey, Veronica. She just drove in from Springfield. Hey, isn't this a great adventure? Isn't this the most awesome adventure ever? Especially since we know our destination. That makes it even better. You know what I'm saying? Well, the reason I picked that song tonight is because I really like it. No, this is Saddle Up Night. So 3 weeks ago, we started a series called Building Our Fellowship. And really, it could be called Building a Fellowship, Building a Church Plant, Building a House Church. It could be Building a Small Group. It could be Building a Bible Study. It all has the same essential foundational building blocks. So last week we talked about, or 2 weeks ago, we talked about the relational building block that I called the Roundup. And that's where you got to grow deeper in your relationships. You gather up people. For us, we went around and just offered music and barbecue, and that's all we need to do, Butch. And Butch and Tippy, they followed us for a year and a half and didn't find us. They were always a day late and a dollar short. But anyway, some of you found us. And as we grew deeper in our relationships, that's what it's all about. And in love. And what's love got to do with it?
Everything.
Okay, you guys were listening. Even the ones that were in southern Arizona. Calvin and Doris have been on a bike road trip across New Mexico and Arizona. So 1,200 miles. 1,600 miles. Yeah, they're the ones yelling out or cowering down when they saw the bike. I don't know which. That's a long trip. It's a long trip. Anyway, and then last week, we talked about transformation. And I called that cowboy up. And first off, there are several elements, and I got to tell you real quick. The first one is the transformation of your soul. First, you have to be transformed by accepting Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. That's the first one of the transformation must. The second one is transformation of your nature, because you got this old nature. All of a sudden, you got the Holy Spirit inside of you, but you're the same old wrapped in flesh bum that you were before. Sorry if I hit a nerve, but it's true. And so that's the sanctification process, where we get better and better and better. And that brings me to the third one on transformation, and that's how we're transformed by the Word of God. And we went deep on how we need transformational study of the Word of God versus informational study. Because it doesn't matter how much you know if you don't go use it. Amen? Okay, glad you're with me. And this week, since we did the roundup, the cowboy up, this is the saddle up, which is the missional building block. If you're gonna all get together and then you're all going to learn something, it doesn't do any good if you don't go somewhere with it. It'd be like circling the wagons. It'd be like a wagon train that just constantly circled the wagons. That'd be silly, wouldn't it? So you got to eventually head out and go somewhere. That's the missional piece, and that's where we're at tonight. Everybody ready for this?
Yeah.
I know you're pumped from that song, Carla. Come on, I know. There's three elements in the missional. And I want to start out with our mission, our witness, and our calling. So if you're taking notes or you're at home, this is good stuff. Our mission. This part seems pretty simple. Everybody's got the mission. If you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, you've got the same mission that I do. And that's a great commission. So Matthew 28, verse 18 through 20, Jesus says, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me." Pause there for a minute, because Jesus is pre-qualifying his statement here in the biggest way that you can possibly ever do. Have you ever known somebody that pre-qualified what they say, like, "Yeah, I went to Yale. Yeah, my dad used to yell at me too." You know what I'm saying? I don't care what somebody's done. I want to see what they're going to do. So Jesus, when he pre-qualifies this, he says, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me." Wow. The buck does stop there. "Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely, surely, I am with you always to the end of the age." So first off, us as believers have to go reach other people who are non-believers. And we can do that in lots of ways. Next week, invite him here. You'll be amazed at what the Holy Spirit will do. The Holy Spirit is the one that convicts. The Holy Spirit's the one that draws. All we can do is say, hey, you want to come to church or want to come to the arena? So that's our mission next week. And then baptizing them, just like Jim's announcement of the baptism next week, if you haven't been baptized or you were baptized for the wrong reasons, if there could be, but you know what I'm saying, like you were sprinkled as a baby or something, come Easter, Resurrection Sunday. You come out of that water. But is that salvation? No. It's an outward expression of an inward belief. And Jim will walk you through it. I've been through his class. He's awesome. It's our testimony. But there's another piece here of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And this is, in the age we live in where there's a cult on every corner, the first identification of a cult is if they don't believe in the Trinity of God. It's all through Scripture. All through Scripture. And the very first statement here is another thing that you'll find almost instantly within a cult, is they don't believe in the authority of Jesus Christ or his kingship or his deity, if you want to call it. They don't believe he's God in the flesh. So these are important foundational issues right here in the Great Commission. And then teaching them to obey everything that I've commanded you, that's the discipleship piece we talked about last week. So all of these are entwined. These foundational building blocks of the relational, the transformational, and the missional, everything's holistically connected somehow. And then one of my favorites is, surely I'll be with you always to the end of the age. Does it say the end of the world? Is everybody sick of that? I mean, come on. The Bible doesn't talk about the end of the world here. It talks about the end of this age, the church age, the age of grace. There's more to come. There's a whole other kingdom age that runs about 1,000 years, last time I checked, with Jesus sitting on the throne in Jerusalem. Jesus. And then there's an eternity for those who have trusted in Christ after that. So this is all good stuff. So that's our mission. That's number one. You got to have that clear. We all, if you're a follower of Christ, this is the same mission that I've got, is to reach people for Jesus Christ. And the second one is your witness. And you go, Frank, isn't that the same thing? Yes, but the mission comes immediately when you get saved. Sometimes the witness comes after being discipled, or I don't know what to say, so I want, I need to go to a Bible study and find out. I need to study apologetics. We've got, in a couple of weeks, Tom Short, campus evangelist. Dave's going to be talking more about it soon. He's going to be here at our service the week after Easter. It's going to be awesome. And he's going to be talking about apologetics as he has to be prepared on the college campuses of America. So he's an evangelist. It's going to be awesome. So our witness is something that we can develop. And you might be going, yeah, but Frank, what about the blind man witness? Well, that's true. When you get in a pinch, you can always go, I don't know anything except I was blind and now I can see. You can always fall on that. But I think it's our obligation to know more. And he wants us to know more. Anybody got an amen? Amen. Okay. I know. That one dessert with the strawberries in it. Somebody said it was good and I licked the bowl. Whatever the name of that was. Oh, Jana, what was the name of what you made? Canyon Casserole. I love the name of it, and it was pretty good too. She started posting on Facebook what she's going to, yeah, sorry. It was awesome. The rest of you start posting on Facebook what you're going to bring. Our attendance will rise. Canyon Casserole. I had to come just to see, well, I was going to come anyway. Canyon Casserole. So our witness. So yes, it's our obligation to know how to answer the tough questions. Well, God says that he will give us power. Acts 1:8, this is a verse everybody should have in their heart. It says, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in Judea and in Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Well, in context of this verse, if you go read Acts chapter 1, Jesus is getting ready to ascend to sit at the right hand of the Father. And he's telling the disciples, go to Jerusalem, hide out till the Holy Spirit comes. And the Holy Spirit came and it was awesome. For us believers, that happens when we get saved. And we will receive power because we have the Holy Spirit on board to be his witnesses. So what's the Jerusalem thing? Well, they were in Jerusalem, okay? But for us, that's like this area. Maybe not Lone Jack, maybe this Jackson County, I don't know. But then it spreads out, or the four county area. And then of course, you know, you spread on out to Judea. Ever been there? They got a Sonic there. Samaria and to the ends of the earth. Doug just got back from the Philippines. You know, we had, Richard was in South America, built a church last summer. You were in China. There's probably stories all over the room. It isn't always outreach right here, even though next week you've got the awesome opportunity to go on a mission trip right here at home. And by the way, I want to thank CMA way out in front, chapter 49. They're going to do our parking next weekend. Love the bikers. And that brings me to my next point, our witness. In 4 weeks, I'm going to do a two-week series called the Witness Protection Program. It's going to be good, let me tell you. But to briefly touch on a few of those things, we've talked about our witness should be bold, faithful, and credible. Can you say it with me? Bold, faithful, and credible. You guys that have been around a while have heard it a million and one times. But it's important to get this into your DNA. Bold, and I don't mean so bold you're just going up and, hey, you're going to go to hell if you don't. No, I'm just talking about you're not afraid. Not afraid. Not afraid just to say it. Matter of fact, I've got a great verse for that. Romans 1:16, another verse you should have memorized. For I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God for salvation for everyone who believes. The power of God. The verse before Acts 1:8 says, we will receive power. Are you feeling powerful? You should. God doesn't want a bunch of wimps going, I just don't know. I just don't know what to say. Don't really know if I want to go out there. It's cold. You guys are tough. You guys are tough. You brave the Snowmageddon forecast. Some of you know their ratings are up, and it's still just raining, but it's okay. Yeah. So you guys are bold naturally. So you're not ashamed of the gospel. That's being bold. That's, you know, that's just, you need to be bold. We are on point. We are on mission here. Also, we're on the front lines, not just anywhere, but we're behind enemy lines on the front lines. Is it supposed to be easy? No. Is it going to be scary? Yes. But remember, we know the ending. We win. We win. So let's be bold. And what about faithful? I love this verse from 1 Peter 3:15. Be ready at all times to answer anyone who asks you to explain the hope you have in you, but do it with gentleness and respect. That's for you guys that are rude. Not me. Be ready at all times to answer anyone who asks you to explain the hope that you have in you. That's apologetics. That's when somebody comes up and goes, well, what about, you know, and they have a pretty good question, and you're going, well, let me get back with you. And that's fine as long as you get back with them. But if you go cowering off with your tail between your legs, limping, it's not good. So try to have some of these things on the tablet of your heart. There's, Tom Short's going to be excellent. Bring a pad and paper. You will be able to write down things where you can answer things that are being asked on a college campuses, and you don't get any tougher than that. You know, our next generation has been steeped with agnosticism and atheism and all kinds of New Age fantasies and stuff. It's just crazy. So if you can answer them, you can for sure answer the guy driving the John Deere across the pasture. He's not going to have a real tough one for you. So let's start there. How do we explain that God breathed the universe into existence? I take it in stride. One guy told me one time, says, Frank, you got too much faith. Well, what do you mean? He says, well, you just take everything on its word. I said, no, it's on his word. It's on his word. And he said, it happens, and I just take it hook, line, and sinker because I want to be reeled in to eternity. Amen? Fishers of men, let's get our fishing poles ready. The fishing is good. Oh, man, oh, man, this is good stuff. Credible. Galatians chapter 6, verse 15 and 16. I read this last week because it blew my mind the week before. Maybe you've never seen it. What counts is whether we have been transformed into a new creation. May God's peace and mercy be upon all who live by this principle. They are the new people of God. So what counts is that you've been transformed into a new creation. The old things are gone. The new things have come. We are a new creation. Are you living it? That's where the credibility comes in. Are you living like a new creation? Are you living like the new people of God? I'm sure that you do when you're in here, or if you're watching at home, I'm sure you do when you're, you know, at home or in church or around mom and dad or whatever it is, but how about when you're not around them? Are you a credible witness? Are you who you say you are? And I don't need to bring up any examples. You know what I'm talking about. So bold, faithful, and credible. So we covered our mission. We covered our witness, which we're going to cover hugely in about 4 weeks. And then what comes next is our calling. You think that would be right off the bat too. No, you have to get your mission, you have to get your witness, and then you have to discover your calling. Now, people try all kinds of different things, and there's nothing wrong with that at all. But I found a couple of verses that have helped me to realize, hey, God's got all the answers. Have you ever just dawned on you, like in the middle of the night, God is in charge? I mean, we talk about it all the time. God's in charge. He sits sovereignly on the throne, does whatever he wants. We don't pull his strings, all those things. And yet we're trying to force everything. We're trying to put square pegs and round holes, and it's just crazy. So when you're looking for your calling in Christ Jesus, look no farther than God. So we have been called to his purpose. Romans chapter 8, verse 28 says, for we know that in all things God works for the good of those who love him and who have been called according to his purpose. To whose purpose? Okay, his purpose. I love that God works too. And I know that in all things God works for the good. God works. There's a TV station here in town that says, working for you. He's working for us. I'm so excited about that. And he doesn't sleep. He doesn't sleep. Doris, remember when your dad said the thing he hated about horses is they never slept. They ate all night. I'm paraphrasing your dad on this. But the idea was they never slept. They're eating all the time, which is stressful when you're the one putting up the hay. But I'm glad that God doesn't sleep. Aren't you? And we're called according to his purpose, according to this verse, which was written by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. So I take it by faith. You can call me dumb. You've called me dumb before. I know. I was told. His purpose. And then 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 6 says, God works through different people in different ways. Oh, boy. But it is the same God who achieves his purpose through them all. Have you ever noticed that we all are kind of different? I mean, some of you guys are really different. Woo! We're talking really different. You know what I'm saying? I never saw this demonstrated as much as when I was watching the drill team last week, because it was twofold. Oh, I got the drill team here. Hang on, let me go over here. This is good, though. But I was noticing the different riders first. They all have different backgrounds, different disciplines. Butch playing Jesus, rodeo guy. You know, you got people that have been in the show ring, people that are trail riders. That's complicated enough, but the horses, they were all different. Different disciplines, different sizes, different shapes, different colors, different temperaments. But they were all called to a purpose. Now, you can go see drill teams where every horse is matched perfectly and all that, but this was priceless to me because it's the picture of the body of Christ. We'd all look different. Aren't you glad? And we all have different backgrounds, and we all have our diverse histories. And I love the people in rural areas. They have independent natures and rugged individualists. You know, our hero is John Wayne, didn't answer anybody but God, and that kind of thing. But there's some places you go, and everybody wants to look exactly the same. Exactly the same. I had that thought when I went to junior high from Greenwood. I actually went to Greenwood Grade School right near you. Yeah. I can show you the window I broke out first grade. Principal's window, too. That was luck. But when I went to junior high, here's this guy, like hundreds of people. And for just a brief second, I wished I had white pants with penny loafers. I know. I went home and told Mom and Dad, and it didn't go over too big. So I went back with my jeans and boots. But the thing is, God wants us to be different. He made us as different as the snowflakes, as different as our fingerprints on our hands. He wants us to be different because he has, according to this verse, different purposes. And I'm not even going to get into the gifting part. That really gets wild. I mean, that'll blow your mind when you start thinking about that. And it all comes together for God's purpose. For God's purpose. So that was, we've been called to his purpose, and we've been called to grow our fellowship. Romans 14, verse 19 says, "Let us concentrate on these things, on the things which make for harmony and growth in our fellowship together." Well, duh, we're supposed to be in harmony. We talked about that week one. That's why all these things are in a holistic, with a holistic approach in mind. We need to seek harmony within our fellowship, but also growth. So are we talking about physical growth, or are we talking about spiritual growth? Well, I think it has to be some of both, doesn't it? If you're just talking about physical growth, you end up one of those churches that's a mile wide and an inch deep. It looks really good on the outside. I mean, they got a paved parking lot, okay? But it's shallow. And if you're only concentrated on the spiritual growth, you end up an inch wide and a mile deep, and it's a long ways to hold your breath to get to the bottom. Holistically, we want to grow spiritually and physically, because it gets back to that circling of the wagon things. If we go, okay, our church is big enough, shut the doors. Circle the wagons. No, you want to think about new people, reaching people for Christ, reaching lonely people out here in the country that don't have a fellowship, people that have been burnt by religion, all kinds of different reasons. You want to reach them, but you want to be growing in depth spiritually. Amen? And we really concentrate on that around here with all of our studies, and we don't grow very deep on Saturday night, but it's okay. I have Tony leading our adult Bible study for the real growth, depth growth. I said that backwards. But the thing is, we are growing spiritually. We are getting stronger, and we are taking ground. Joshua chapter 1, God says everywhere we put our feet, we're taking ground for him. Are we giving up ground? No, we don't want to give up ground. So hold tight in the lines. We've been called to build our fellowship. Dave and I, when we started out, we had a slogan. I don't know where Dave got it, but I love it. We called it our BS strategy. I know. And then we made it even worse. We said, or better, depending on which way you're looking at it, we said double BS. So when we're at a pastor's conference or somewhere where there's pastory kind of people there, we love saying that. And they're going, oh, my gosh. But we mean build slow and build strong. Build slow, build strong. Double BS. Get it now? Okay, I'm good. Build slow, build strong. That's what we've tried to do here. But we are building, growing physically and spiritually, building our fellowship. If it wasn't just spiritual, we wouldn't have these kickboards out here or people that are saying, hey, I want to buy a load of gravel. There's physical things that have to happen too to grow a church. We don't like to talk about them all the time, but they're there. It's all holistically a part of building the church of Jesus Christ. And don't think of this little church here. Think of the universal church. I was having a conversation this afternoon with Bishop Polycap in Kenya. And he was talking about Holy Week this week and different things they're preparing for and stuff. But it's pretty cool. I would never have talked to a pastor that pastors 15 churches on foot in Kenya if it wasn't for our media back here, our video. Dave doesn't want me to say his name, so I won't. But the people that had a vision on, hey, let's broadcast and let's go fishing and let's see who we caught. And we've had some great success that way too, a little redneck church with a big vision. Right, Sandy? Amen. I caught him sleeping. Remember in school when they'd say your name and you're like, oh. I thought if I was ever a teacher, I'd go ahead and just ask it again. I hate putting people on the spot. Of course, if I was a cop, I'd never give a ticket. And that's why we're called to different things. Okay, let's just move on from there. And then the last one, we've been called to be his workmen. You know, he didn't call us to be couch potatoes. I don't even like being a couch potato. I was thinking, if it snows tomorrow, I'm not going to move. Well, that's never going to happen. That lasts about 10 minutes. But, you know, he doesn't want us to be couch potatoes spiritually. He wants us to be out there serving some way. And when we focus on our fivefold purposes, discipleship, fellowship, worship, prayer, and service, you stay physically and spiritually fit, right? You stay spiritually fit because you're doing exactly what God wants you to do. You stay physically fit because you're running around with your head cut off. That was supposed to be a joke. Should have tried it out earlier. I should have just said it over here. Because you're running around with your head cut off. They laughed and I left the chicken thing out. Our people that follow us in Nebraska, they're laughing. But I don't know about Kenya. They're going, what? Chickens? 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 15 says, do your best to present yourself to God as one approved, a workman who does not need to be ashamed and who correctly handles the word of truth. This should be a mind blower for you. I mean, this should just make you just want to jump up and down. Anybody want to jump up and down? Do it. Okay. Because you've been approved. Remember the pre-qualification thing? I'll try that one over here. Yeah, I went to Yale. No, never mind. Tough crowd over here. It's drill team. They're focused. Now they're going, we don't look the same and our horses don't look the same. That's a good thing. We've been approved. We've been approved. So it says, do your best to present yourself as one. You've already been approved. If you're a follower of Christ, you've been adopted into the family of God. You've been washed in the blood of Jesus. He paid for your sins. He's given you a purpose. He's gifted you in multiple ways. All of this stuff's good. But it says present yourself as one. Present yourself to God as one approved. It doesn't mean that, remember that hang down hound dog look thing? And you're going, I don't know if I fit in or I don't know if I can, if I'm up to the task or I don't know. No, present yourself as one approved. One approved. And then it says, a workman who does not need to be ashamed and who correctly handles the word of truth. You know how important it is to correctly handle the word of God? There's a warning in the book of Revelation if you change it. And when you think about all the cults that change it or take it out of context on purpose or who deceive people or who lead people astray, and you're going, man, they're going to pay someday. And that's okay because they will, but also be thinking, I better handle it right myself. Because we all have ways of picking out little verses and go, well, you know, it's kind of like when we started studying the book of James on Wednesday mornings. I told the guys, I said, every time I've gone to the book of James, I think of how many people that I know that should read this. You know what I'm saying? They need this. They all need to read this. But we need to go to the book of James in particular and sit in front of a mirror and make sure every verse is bouncing right back at you. But not one of those magnifying mirrors from the hotels. I can't take those. I don't like seeing the pores in my face. You guys are probably seeing them, but I don't want to see them. In our new bathroom, Doug's putting in candlelight for our, whatever they call them, the light over the mirror. Yeah, 2-watt bulb. And I just shave with one of those razors. Remember when you were a kid and you'd take guys, not the girls, and you'd take the razor out and just shave with no razor? That's what I do. Safe shaving is what they call that. And then Ephesians 2:10 says, "For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared in advance for us to do." So we're not only his workmen, we're his workmanship. Are you acting like you're proud? I don't mean earthly pride. But hey, I'm a workman of God. I've got a responsibility here. I've got an obligation here to handle the word of truth, to handle people. I recently bobbled a situation and hurt someone's feelings. And I could just kill myself, really. I mean, I do not like to do that. So we need to always be on guard because we are approved workmen. We've been approved. And we're also God's workmanship, prepared to do good works in advance, by the way. So when we talk about our mission and our witness and our calling, and as we close this series, Building Our Fellowship, and we kind of got a good handle on the relational or the roundup and the transformational, the cowboy up, and tonight the missional, the saddle up, that we are going somewhere and there are certain ways that we handle it. And here's the little diagram of it. Coop's amazing, isn't he? He's a workman approved. So are you. So are you. And so are you at home. You've been approved if you're in Christ Jesus. We're going somewhere. You guys ready to saddle up? Yeah. Let's close our eyes. Oh, boy. You know, there's always so much that I don't know if you guys ever learn anything when we come together, but boy, I do. And I learn things about myself that are ugly, but I also learn things that are beautiful in the sight of God. And one is that I'm cloaked in the righteousness of Jesus Christ. You know, when God looks down upon me, he doesn't see the bum that I am. He sees Jesus Christ, his spotless son. But there might be someone watching at home or even in this room that doesn't know Jesus Christ. And I don't mean that you don't know his name. You'd have to be living under a rock to not know the name of Jesus Christ, but who he is and what he did. That he is the living Son of God, that he's the second person of the Godhead, that he came and wrapped himself in flesh so he could be the perfect, spotless sacrifice, the Lamb of God on the cross. And in this, especially in this holy week where he enters Jerusalem tomorrow morning and has his last full week of ministry before going to the cross. You need to know what he did. And if you believe that he is who he says he is, and if you do believe what happens next, that he was pulled off that cross and he was put into a borrowed tomb. You see, he was homeless. And the stone was rolled away. He rose from the dead. Scripture says the first of many, talking about us to follow. If you don't know this Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, but you want to, just say yes to him right now. Say, Lord, I want you in my heart. I want you to save me, to rescue me. You're the only one that can do it. I know that now because I'm a sinner that needs a Savior, and you're the Savior, and I'm the sinner. And Lord, come into my life and fill me with your Holy Spirit and fill me with purpose and promise. Fill me with everything to look forward to and nothing to look over my shoulder at except a testimony maybe. And I ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, who has all authority, as we read in Matthew chapter 28. With our eyes down, if there's anyone in the room that wants to say yes to Christ, just lift a little hand up. No one's looking around. Anybody that wants to seal the deal tonight in this room? Anybody who wants Jesus tonight? God bless you. Is there anyone else? God bless you, sweetheart. Angels are starting to celebrate. Is there anyone else tonight? Okay, if you're listening at home and you want to accept Christ, you just did. Contact me somehow through our website. And for the rest of you here tonight, as you've seen the different building blocks, the relational, do you struggle in any of those areas? Loving people, forgiving people. Last week we talked about the transformational. Are you being transformed? Are you stepping forward? Are you moving? Or are you stuck? And then tonight, with the missional, do you see clearly that we've got a mission, not just to reach this area, but to reach the world, the bigger picture? And it starts next week, right in the arena. And are you ready to saddle up? If there's anybody that wants to make ground on any of those issues, just lift a little bit of a hand tonight. God bless you and you and you, hands all over the room. Lord, thank you so much that you had the answer, that you had the plan, that your word is inspired, that we don't have to question that. That we can just relish in the fact that you are a sovereign God who can't be bought off, can't be bribed. Nobody can mess with you. That's solid ground. That's solid. Christ, the solid rock I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. Lord, put a fire in us. Let us take these flyers and give them to people we'd never think to give them to. And change us forever. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Anybody happy? Anybody ready to saddle up? You know, I got to say this before I go any farther. Right after the service, if you signed up to sing, we have a new song director, Sue Harriman. Lift your hand up. Oh, yeah. And they're going to have a meeting right after the service. But if you signed up too to be a greeter or a hospitality person and we haven't got back with you, we are now. So after the service, I want to talk to you guys because we start Saturday night and we'll carry it right over into Sunday. And God's got a purpose for you. And it's going to rock your world. And Veronica's got one thing to say too.